Wow, how do I follow that?
I think it's working. There we go. Well, good morning. I'm Nick Klemp. I'm the administration pastor here at Journey Church. Thank you so much for choosing to be here this morning and a part of our worship. We are a family of believers made up of imperfect people that are following a perfect Lord. And our desire is just to be a people that are living by faith, that are known by our love and are a voice of hope in our community and beyond. And so we're really glad that you're here this morning. If you're new to Journey Church, please take some time this morning. Stop at our cafe. We have a free gift for you just for being our visitor here this morning. And if you have any questions while you're here, look for someone that has a lanyard on like this, and they can either answer that question for you or point you in the right direction to get the answer that you need. If you are here and you call Journey Church your home, don't forget that we have multiple ways that you can continue your worship with giving, whether that's online at our website, with our app, by texting it in, or in person here at the drop box just out by the cafe there in the lobby. And also out in the lobby, you'll see there are several flyers around that say ways to serve. And if you're looking for ways to get more involved here at Journey Church and serve God with your talents, all you need to do is to go to that little flyer and scan the QR code that's there, and it'll take you to a form that you can fill out that will connect you. You can fill it out. It'll connect you to the right person for that ministry that you're interested in. You can also go to our website, iJourneyOnline.com, and go to the Get Involved tab, and you'll see the ways to serve there as well. If you have any questions or thoughts about that process, just come and talk to me, and I can help you through that. Then on May 12th, we're going to have a child dedication during the service. You know, in Proverbs 22:6, it says that we are to train up a child in the way they should go. And so this child dedication is a time for parents to come before the church, before God, with their young one to say, we are going to do all that we can to bring up our child in the ways of the Lord, to pray for them, to be an example. And it's also a time for our church to remember that we are a community of faith, and we all have a responsibility to train up our young people in the ways of the Lord, not just through teaching, but through our attitudes, through how we treat each other, how we reach out to others in love, how we're an example for them to see. And so this is, of course, not a decision for a child to follow Christ. That's for their individual choice. But to bring someone up in ways that supports them to make that decision at some point. And so that at the end of that verse where it says that they will not depart from it. And so if you have not had a time when you have dedicated your child to God, please speak with Pastor John or myself or Brian about it, and we can help you through that process. And then lastly, on May 11th, we are going to have a spring cleanup day here at our grounds at Journey Church. It's going to start at 8 a.m., and you can come when you can or stay as long as you can. At noon, we're going to have pizza and drinks together and just a time of cleaning up our grounds. So plan on bringing your gloves, your rakes, your shovels, any yard tool that you think might help in cleaning up our area around our church. And then just as a reminder that before service and after service, we have the slides that play all the time with this information. So if you ever need to find that information or get some more, or even on our website, we have all of that up there that you can continue to look at and use as a reminder of things going on around here. So thank you again so much for being here with us this morning.
Psalm 47:1, just clap your hands, all you nations, shout to God with cries of joy. And that's what I tried to have you all do during that first song, just to get a little bit of movement in you, get a little bit of excitement in you, because we are supposed to be joyful in front of the Lord. And if you think about everything in today's society that we get involved in and we watch and we look at and we cheer and we clap and it comes out naturally without even thinking about it. Most of the time you'll start clapping for something and it's not like, nobody had to tell you to do that. And you just did it. And that is the way that that joy should flow out of us to God. Now, the rest of the songs this morning, I'm not going to ask you to clap, but I am going to ask you to sing and sing out with your voices in praise to Him this morning.
Thank you. Morning, everyone. Good to see you today. Wow, what a great turnout yesterday for our ladies' event. Yeah. That was so cool. I just came at the end. I'm not allowed to come on those kind of things, so I just came at the end, and it was so great to see all the ladies just mingling and laughing and having a great time together. Thank you, Jen. Appreciate that. But then, my heart was so filled with joy because of last week. We had a couple of men step up and get baptized last weekend, and what a great celebration that was. And I want to do something, just really an acknowledgement that they were baptized. I like giving out a little certificate that lets them really keep a record and just remember that day, and it's just so good to do that. So I'd like to give a couple certificates out to Aaron and Matthew, if you guys just want to step up here real quick. Love you. As we said last week, the two biggest dudes in the church got baptized. So we got that out of the way. From now on, you got to come down from 6'5", you know. So nobody over, how tall are you, Aaron? That, yeah, huh? Nobody bigger than that can get baptized from now on. So, not true. Gee whiz, this whole series we've been doing, it's been fun for me. I hope you've been learning a little bit along the way. We're in the body of Christ, right? Just trying to realize how important the body is and that some things that are vital, that's where we're at right now, how things are vital to what we are doing as a body and how important that is for the health of the body, but then also when we walk out these doors, how real important that truly is. One of the things I did notice because today we're going to talk about joy, and one of the things I noticed is that during worship time today, Jen tried to get you clapping. They say that after a pastor is, you know, in his congregation for a period of time, they begin to take on the characteristics of their pastor. That's true, because I watched all of you. You were trying to like... You couldn't clap and get your foot going at the same time. You know who you are, right? It was really cool. It was really good. I love it. I love clapping. I love praising the Lord. And today we're going to talk about joy because when it comes to joy, I think as Christians we're kind of really don't understand what it is, and then sometimes we even have trouble showing it, to be honest. And we're going to talk about that today. We got plenty of reasons we should be doing this. So we've labeled it vital joy because it can be a kind of like a symptom, if you want to say, if we're healthy or not. In other words, if we're full of joy as a church, a local church, and as church at large, it's pretty healthy because we understand what real joy is, and we're going to talk about that. But also, if we don't show much joy and don't have much joy, then maybe we're not as healthy as we should be. And so that's why we've called it a vital. It's interesting. Joy shows up a bunch in our Bible. It shows up a good 150 times. If you count words like joyous and joyful, though it's another couple hundred times it shows up. And then even if you talk about the verb rejoice, in other words, that's what joy makes you do, then there's a couple more hundred times that is in there. So a good 450 times or so this shows up in our Bible. So I think it's important, right? And so joy is our topic. It's closely related to gladness and happiness. They're kind of like distant cousins in a sense, and I think even we get those mixed up a little bit too, what they really are. Joy is more of a state of being, though. It's kind of like who you are. Not so much, even though it does come out, it's about who you really are, and like I said, we're going to study that today. Joy is the condition we are currently in. Whereas happiness and things of that emotional state is exactly that. They kind of come and go based on circumstances around us. And our happiness, as you all know, seems to be so up and down, doesn't it? Especially in this world. I'm certain that you are aware, just as myself, that when you live in this present world, it'll suck the joy right out of you, won't it? It'll try to take the joy right out of your life. However, real joy, no matter what is going on in our life, will be static. It won't fluctuate like happiness does. Joy should be there in all circumstances, good, bad, and ugly. Do you ever be around people that just seem to like have this joy all the time? It's pretty awesome, actually. You ever wonder how they do it? You know, how do you keep, man, there's bad things going on in your life right now. How do you stay there? How can you do this? We're actually drawn to it, actually. It's kind of like it's magnetic, isn't it? We actually want to be like them. And no, they're not aliens from another planet or anything like that or some freak of nature. Actually, joy is something that every person can have. Every person, no matter who you are, can have it. Yes, even us grumpy ones can have it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for worship. Thank you that we get to worship you in love. It was so good, Lord, just remembering who you are, remembering what you've done. Lord, you're so good to us, way beyond anything that we deserve. So, Lord, we come, we worship, even now. We just ask that you would use words, your words, today to encourage someone. Maybe somebody needs their joy recharged. Maybe somebody has never really felt true joy. And just pray, Lord, that somehow you use the scriptures to show that, to help us, to heal us. Lord, we just ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So joy is an inward reality that expresses itself outwardly. Think about that for a second. Joy is an inward reality, it's real, that expresses itself outwardly. So that's maybe why some of you were having a little trouble today. You know, you have the joy. In fact, my grandkids are hanging out with us this weekend, and we were singing that song this morning. If you've been in maybe raised in church and been around youth groups and things like that, we got the joy, joy, joy. Where? Where? All right, we got some youth group kids here today. Very cool. But that's where the joy is. It just comes out. It gets expressed. It's something that's inside of us. It is the display of joy in all circumstances that actually characterizes true Christians. Now, that's the people, they look like aliens to us. We wonder how they're going through all these different things in their lives and stuff. And they just seem to still have the joy no matter what is going on. It's a characteristic of someone who has a right relationship with God Almighty. Joy, actually, is part of the fruit of the Spirit. You guys probably know that, Galatians 5, right? Galatians 5:22 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, there's our word, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, and then in 23, gentleness and self-control. But how we get joy actually comes down the line in a sense. You know, right relationship with God starts with a receiving of what Jesus Christ has done for us. And then after we accept Christ, the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of us and begins to make fruit in our lives. And joy is just one of those things. Because joy is the fruit of the Spirit, then, kind of flip that around, joy can only come from God. We can't have true God without a true relationship with Him. We can have fakes, we can have rip-offs, we can have things that are similar, but this true, grounded, in all circumstance kind of joy can only come from God. When we look within our natural man, who we are, I'll say, naturally, just from our mother's womb, without the Spirit of God inside of us, joy is nowhere to be found. You can't find it. It's not inside. It's just not there. We need the Spirit to do that. So no matter how we try, muster through this thing on our own strength, we try to produce joy and we can't do it. Like you said, we get these kind of pseudo joy things that are going on in our lives. We only have real joy when we look outside of ourselves to Christ. And that's the big difference between some of these things we're talking about, happiness and gladness and other terms that we use, these emotions. This is the inborn joy, if you want to say, that is only when we look outside of ourselves to Christ can really happen. If you're a Christian, you can only find joy inside of you. But in reality, really, joy found you. And what I mean by that, in Luke 15, a real cool scenario, is probably one of the most, laid out parables. There's three parables there that tell us how joyful God is. And that's where joy comes from. God exhibits joy. And let's look for a moment what he actually gets all excited about. When the Pharisees and the scribes have criticized Jesus, of course, for receiving sinners and eating with them, you may remember eating this, but Jesus would invite sinners to eat with him and to dine with him, and people criticized this. So Jesus told three parables to follow that up. One was about the lost sheep, one about the lost coin, and of course, the other one about the lost son. But the theme of each one of these things is joy. So many people look at this and think the theme is the lost, and not totally wrong. But the overwhelming theme of these three parables is how much joy God exhibits during them. So let's look at one of those. The one in the middle is the lost coin. Starting in verse 8 of Luke 15. Or what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls her friends and her neighbors together, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the piece which I had lost." Likewise, Jesus says, "I say to you, there is joy in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents." And that's the theme of all three of these parables. Even though there are parables talking about objects and other people, this is God talking here. This is God's joy pouring out over a lost person that does not know him. And when he finds that person and they repent and turn, all joy breaks out, if you want to say. He rejoices. And if that's not enough, all of heaven breaks out in joy, God's joy, over the lost sinner who repents. So this is how joy actually gets transferred to us. First, we understand how much God loves us and how much he wanted to find us because we're lost. We're lost in this broken and tragic world and fallen world right now. And next thing you know, God finds us. We look to him, repent, and he rejoices because he's found us and we repent. Found us and we repent. And because of that, we have all kinds of joy now. And that's how the joy gets started. It actually gets transferred. God's joy gets transferred into us through the receiving of the Holy Spirit, but looking back to God on how much he cares and how much he loves us. We cannot have God's joy apart from Christ. We said that. Joy is not something we can conjure up, like you said, or make up on our own. However, it doesn't stop us from trying. You ever notice how we try to conjure up or make our own joy? And one of the first places we really turn to is the craziest place in the whole wide world is the actual world itself. We try to find joy in the world. Again, if we look to the inside of ourselves, natural man, there's nothing there. So we got to go looking for joy. And what do? We go to the world and look for joy. And the world calls it pleasure. It's not really joy. It's a different word. It's pleasure. And we try to find these things in this world. But the world cannot produce joy. It's only pleasure it can produce. The Bible distinguishes between these two, joy and pleasure. The Greek word for pleasure is the word we get our hedonism. And if you understand hedonism, it's just nothing more than the philosophy of self-centeredness. It's who we are. It's all about us. And so when it's all about you, guess what we do? We go out and try to please ourselves. That's not joy, that's pleasure. Unfortunately, our culture is full of those seeking for joy this way. It's the natural thing we do. The scriptures speak of this misguided pursuit. 2 Timothy 3, verse 1 through 4 says this, "But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come." And you go, why are the perilous times coming? He lays it out. "For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty." And then he finishes it off with "lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God." This is why the world is messed up, because it's all internal. It's all hedonism. It's all about seeking pleasures to please self, the opposite of what we would call joy. So pleasure is not joy at all. In fact, Solomon, the wisest man of all in biblical times, probably ever, had the most wisdom. God, he asked for wisdom. Said, God asked him, "What do you want?" And he says, "I want wisdom." And so God gave it to him. But Solomon pursued things in life. Even with all this great wisdom, he still went out and pursued things. Let's look at in Ecclesiastes 2 what he said. He said, "I said in my heart, come now, I will test you with mirth," or pleasure, or another word for pleasure, "therefore enjoy pleasure. But surely this also was vanity," or for nothing, or just the word actually there in the Hebrew is like breath. It's just like wind. It's like nothing. So he pursued it. He told his heart that this is what we're going to do, heart. We're going to go out and try to please us. Solomon records this sad testimony of one who sought this life with pleasures. And let's look at what he says. The search left him empty and joyless. If you go down a few verses from there in chapter 2 of Ecclesiastes, start in verse 10, he says, "Whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I did not withhold my heart from any pleasure, for my heart rejoiced in my labor." There's our word. There's our action verb there is rejoice. He rejoiced, but look at what he rejoiced in. "And this was my reward from all my labor." Solomon's reward from pleasure seeking was that he had joy in his work. That was the end all. He was working. He did a lot of things. If you know anything about Solomon, he built cities and, you know, he built walls and he just was an amazing builder. But at the end of the day, he goes, "The only thing I got out of this pleasure seeking in life was just I enjoyed my work." Pretty sad when you think about it. Verse 11 says, "Then I looked on all the works my hands had done and on the labor in which I had toiled, and indeed all was vanity and grasping for the wind. There was no profit under the sun. Solomon proved to himself, pleasure cannot produce joy. He was just happy, in a sense. He was just happy because while he was working, things were going good. I enjoyed it. I liked it. But he didn't have joy. Pleasures actually choke off our source of joy. Right when we think that we're pursuing the proper thing and we're going for joy, we want to pursue these things in life, the Bible says that it actually chokes them off. That's what pleasure does. You remember when Jesus taught on the parables of the soils, right? He told about the sower casting out seeds and the different types of soil that the seed would land on. We are told that the seed in the parable represents the word of God, so he's using another illustration how to help us understand that as the word of God is thrown out there, it lands on different hearts. It lands on all types of different hearts, and all the different soils are representation of those hearts. In that parable, one of the soils contained thorns that grew alongside the seed as it began to sprout up. Luke 8:14 is a record of that. It says, now the ones that fell, the seeds that fell among the thorns, notice he shifts right here to people. He says, are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked. And what are they choked with? The cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. It's interesting that the word falls on all of our hearts differently. And he's in this parable, it's really just explaining the thorns that are out there, the pleasures of this world. There's plenty of them growing up alongside of us. But those thorns, if we're not careful, if we pursue the pleasures of this life, the thorns of this life, they'll actually choke off the fruit that the Word of God is actually supposed to produce in our lives. We know that by reading God's Word and obeying it, it's a vital part of our relationship with God and in maintaining joy. That's crucial to that. If we're vacant of reading or void of reading the Word of God, you'll actually start seeing your joy kind of dissipate. You might not even know it. But that's actually what is going on here. And Jesus warns of that, that in this pleasures of this life is what actually can choke off the fruit from the Word of God. Pleasures are also deceiving, very deceiving, actually. And Titus reminds of this. Paul in the book of Titus, chapter 3, verse 3, says, for we ourselves, talking about past, were also once foolish, disobedient, and deceived. How were we deceived? Serving lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. The pleasures that we think are going to produce all this great joy, who ends up serving who in the end is the question. Paul tells us through Titus that actually we end up serving the actual thing that we thought was going to serve us and give us pleasure. It actually, we become its slave as opposed to the other way around. Interesting, isn't it? It's Jesus, not pleasures, that bring us joy. Even before Jesus arrived, he was bringing joy. I thought about this week and I was trying to think in my head some things that, where do I remember like the most joy as I read through the scriptures? And it was actually the coming of Jesus Christ is what all the joy is talked about, especially in the New Testament. Remember when the angel announced to Zacharias and Elizabeth that, you know, John the Baptist was going to come, who was the forerunner, right, of Jesus. So John the Baptist is going to go out there and tell everybody that Jesus is on his way. And when the angel announces this to them, he says, and you will have joy and gladness, Luke 1:14, and many will rejoice at his birth. Pretty interesting. Pregnant Elizabeth says this as pregnant Mary approaches her. Another opportunity for joy to be talked about. Luke 1:44, for indeed as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, Elizabeth says, the babe Jesus leaped in my womb How? For joy. Jesus leaped, made John the Baptist leap in Elizabeth's womb. It's pretty crazy to me. Now, how is that done? Well, remember, Mary was conceived of the Holy Spirit, and we know that Jesus is God. But then we often talk about, is our children alive in the womb and all those kinds of things. We got babies leaping in wombs because Jesus is coming to earth. So as I thought through more of these things and talking about joy in this life, Jesus brings all the joy. And listen to the wise men's reaction as they realize Jesus is coming to earth. Matthew 2:10 says, when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. So we got wise men anticipating the birth of Jesus, and when they see the sign, the star, rejoice with exceedingly great joy. And probably the most familiar one is the angel's announcements to the shepherds, right? Luke 2:10, it says, then the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. So before Jesus actually even lands on earth, and then once he hits, joy is a part of who Jesus is. And that's my point here today, is that that's where we're going to get our true joy. Apart from Jesus Christ, we're not going to have what the Bible calls joy. We may shoot at some things. We may have some emotions that are tied to our life in this world. Apart from Jesus, we'll have no true joy. Jesus came to earth to save mankind from the penalty of sin, right? He died in our place, was buried, and rose 3 days later from the dead so that we might have eternal life. Oh my goodness, if that's all we knew of the scriptures, if that's all we had, it would be enough to hold us from our whole entire time here on earth full of joy. If we knew that Jesus came to rescue us like he did, if we really got a true understanding of that, there's nothing in this life that could knock the joy out of us if we reflect on what he has really done. The God of creation has come, rescued us, and he's going to take us to eternity one day. Christians should be the most joyful people on the planet because we know this. We've trusted Jesus. We've asked him to rescue us. But yet, unfortunately, it's not always this way. We can find ourselves without joy, or maybe a little less joyful than we should be. And why is this? Why does this happen? Well, Jesus says, in this world you will have what? Trouble. We'll have trouble in this world. So we will have trouble, but we still should have our joy. And that's the point this morning. We just have to watch the news one time and see all the trouble that the world's in these days. I don't know if you watch the news at all. I try to watch it once in a while, catch up on a few things, but it's like, oh man, I can't turn this off fast enough. We're in trouble. The world's in trouble. And Jesus said that this would come. But do we lose our joy during the process? Is it something that goes away? If we find ourselves losing our joy during this process of seeing how crazy the world is, then we don't have true joy. True joy is meant to be reflected upon what Jesus has done for us and how much God loves us. Because joy is produced by being in the Lord, we can continue to have joy when these things are happening. Paul actually shouts it as a command in Philippians 4:4. He says, rejoice in the Lord sometimes. No, always. Rejoice in the Lord always. It's actually, the way the language is written there, it's a command. Is that we're commanded to rejoice always. Again, he puts a little more emphasis on it. I will say, rejoice. No matter what's happening, Paul says, and we know from Paul's life, that he had plenty going on in his world. Paul ends up dying, actually, because of the current world around him. Rejoice. Rejoice always. Ups, downs, all around. Remember, no matter how we try, none of us can muster enough strength on our own to produce this joy. We can only have real joy when we look outside of ourselves into Christ. No matter what the circumstances are, if we hold them up to the light of the gospel, we really hold them up, no matter what you're going through, remember the gospel. Remember the good news that Jesus Christ came for you and has died for you, and one day you'll be in eternity with him if you put your faith and trust in him. So it sounds nuts. Doesn't mean we don't have sorrow. Doesn't mean that we won't grieve for a period of time. Paul says, don't grieve as those that have no hope. It's okay to grieve, okay to be sad. We can't stay there. We need the internal joy that we have in Jesus Christ has to balance out the stuff that goes on in this world. It can't be, woe is me, woe is the world, and get stuck right there. We have to allow that to be called back into our hearts, out of our heart and into our minds and our thoughts and into our actions. We have to get that sorrow and that grief balanced back out with the joy that is in Jesus. Jesus spoke of those who could rejoice even when persecuted and killed. Matthew 5:12 says, rejoice and be exceedingly glad. There's our phrase again. For great is your reward in heaven, for they persecuted the prophets who were before you. So Paul wrote that rejoicing in suffering is the final fruit. In other words, there's fruit to come out of our suffering. So those things are allowed to make us stronger in our faith and to bring about joy in our lives, to use our joy. Romans 5:3 says, and not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance or long-suffering, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Both Peter and James also echo these words of the Lord's teaching about rejoicing in troubles. 1 Peter 1:6 says, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, and he's talking about troubles, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. That the genuineness of your faith, this is that balancing back out thing again, being much more precious than the gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love. Though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice in joy inexpressible and full of glory. So you can see that the New Testament writers and all through our Bible, everything points to Jesus for joy. And we just need to be reminded so many times, especially as troubles get more and more, and we're all going to go through them. Maybe you've already got a bunch that are in your rear view mirror, but there's probably some ahead as well. We're going to go through troubles in this world. So what do? Go out, walk around with our heads down, no joy, oh, woe is me? No, the Bible's full of encouragement, and that encouragement comes in Jesus Christ. James 1:2 says, brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. How can James say such a thing? Well, because he had the joy of the Lord. So question for everybody this morning. Do you have the joy of the Lord? Honest question, right? If you're here today and claim to be a Christian and you've given your life to Jesus, you have it. But is it coming out? Because remember we said that joy was really that inward heart thing that has to actually be expressed on the outside. Well, first we have to want it. Did you know that? We got joy, it's a fruit, right? It's part of the fruit, but there's a little bit of exercise that has to go on with almost all of those fruits. Is that they're just not automatically, we have them from the Spirit, right? Being in the Spirit. But at the same time, there's some work on our end. Luke 19:1, one of my favorite stories in the Bible because it's about a short guy. It says, then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, There was a man named Zacchaeus who was a chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was. He wanted, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead, climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. See, Zacchaeus had status. He was rich. He just didn't have stature. Difference. He had status and was rich, yet something was still lacking in Zacchaeus' life. Can you imagine having all these things and still not being happy? So we can see that all the things that Zacchaeus had just fell a little bit short of having true joy. So he began to look. He wanted it. Zacchaeus knew it, wanted it, and sought Jesus out. Secondly, we have to receive it. Start in verse 6 of that same chapter. So he made haste and came down. And what? Received him joyfully. He received Jesus into his house. But when they saw it, the nasty dudes, they all complained, saying, he has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Then Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor, and I have taken if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today, salvation has come to this house, because he also is the son of Abraham, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. So what we see is Zacchaeus had everything that this world could offer in his day, yet he was short of joy, and he knew it. But what he had to do, he had to go after it. And who does he seek out? He seeks out Jesus. We really believe here Zacchaeus gets saved that day because of the language that Jesus talks about salvation coming to his house. But he also talks about being a son of Abraham, not through birthright, but through spirit, through faith. And so Abraham gets saved now for the very first time. Zacchaeus receives Jesus joyfully. He repented and bore the fruit of repentance. And for the very, very first time, joy comes into Zacchaeus' life. True joy. He has it for the very first time. He has a right relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And now from this day forward, Zacchaeus is full of joy. Thirdly, others must see our joy. And that's what I think some of us can get stuck in a little bit. We've trusted Jesus. We know we have the joy inside of us, but it just doesn't really seem to come out all that well some days. We go through troubles, and we look like no different than somebody that doesn't know Jesus. Oh, woe is me. We're struggling. Nothing wrong with sharing our, and we'll talk about this in a second, our sorrows with each other. We need each other. That's what the church is for. But we can perpetually get stuck in that place where it's, whoa, woe is me kind of a thing. We lose all of our joy. We never remember anything about our Lord and the promises he brings. Charles Spurgeon, the great 1800s preacher, was emphasizing to his preaching students one day the importance of making facial expressions when they, making them match up with their preaching. So he says, when you speak of heaven, he said, let your face light up. Let it be radiant with a heavenly gleam. Let your eyes shine with reflective glory. But when you speak of hell, well, then use your ordinary face. I'm afraid that too many of us are walking around like we know hell better than we do heaven. And that's what can happen if we allow the stuff around us, the world and everything, to get just kind of so much part of our life, is that we forget all about heaven, forget about the promises of Jesus, we forget about the hope that is in him. All too often in the body of Christ, we lack the outward expression of the area of joy. Do people, are they drawn to you because of your joy? Do they know that you're probably going through one of the worst things in your life right now, but yet you still exhibit the joy of Christ? If that's so, that's why we need to be magnetic. We need to let this joy that is inside come out once in a while. We need to let people know that this is where you find true joy. All your friends, neighbors, relatives, everybody's going to go through hard times just like we do. But how can we stand with this joy and not let it get us down and, you know, not be Chicken Little and the sky is falling kind of attitude? Are you magnetic? Are others drawn to you? Does your joy show is the kind of the thought. Well, as we conclude today, we began saying that joy is vital in the body of Christ. We need joy to be shown to the world. It is a vital thing. It helps us with our own internal health. How do you, if we all had bad things going on at the same time, we'd be all pretty sick, wouldn't we, if there were no joy? But we do have the joy. Do you share your joy along with your sorrows is the question. Well, we're supposed to. Romans 12:15 says this, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. It's a two-way street, guys. Our joy and our sorrows should be interchanging back and forth. Remember how we've been talking about there are many members in the body of Christ and we have many skills and many different giftings that we have. But it's a two-way street. It's not always one person helping the other person out. And it's not a give-give, it's a give and a take. Joy is part of that process. Maybe you're here today and you struggle and you're not full of joy. Maybe your tank's like half full, half empty kind of thing. Maybe you're struggling with rejoicing always. John 15, Jesus instructs his disciples to abide in him, remain close, to keep his commandments, and to produce fruit. Why does Jesus lean on this so hard? Verse 11 says, these things I've spoken to you. Why? That my joy may remain in you. Remember, there's nothing inside of us that's going to be able to produce joy. He actually labels it his joy. His joy may remain in us, and that your joy may be full. Not half, not a quarter, but full. So as we take a few moments, as we always do each and every week here at The Journey, maybe your joy is not full. Maybe the pleasures of this world have choked off your relationship with Jesus. Maybe. That happens. Happens a lot, actually. Especially in good old USA. We have so many things to choose from. So many pleasures. So many things. Feeling a little half full, then maybe take a look at some of those things. Are you trying to get joy from other places? Or perhaps you just haven't stayed as close to him as you should have. Maybe that's part of it. You know, Jesus wanted us to abide in him, be close to him, remain in him, is what the language says. That'll keep our joy meter up if we remain in him. Maybe that's the reason that you're half full. Or perhaps this kind of joy is completely foreign to you, that you could actually say that I have never experienced what you're talking about. I don't know that kind of joy. Well, if that's you, that's because there's a possibility here that you don't know Jesus. Personal experience, he's right. There's no other place you can find true joy outside of a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. If that is you, go to him today. Ask him. No, beg him that you want to receive him. Let him know. Humble yourself before him. Let him know that you have been apart from him and that you want, like Zacchaeus, you want to know him. You want to be with him. You want to receive his forgiveness and joy. Let him know that. And then do just what Zacchaeus did. Repent. Turn from those things that kept you from him. And then, just like Zacchaeus, salvation will come to your home, to your house, to you. With that said, let's take a few minutes to pray. If anybody needs any help, if you need a little help getting to Jesus, I can help you with that. But let's take a few moments and then I'll come back and close. Lord, thank you for showing so much joy when one of us lost comes to you and asks to be forgiven and we repent and we can carry that joy into our lives just being so excited that you love us. You came for us, you found us, you rescued us, and we'll be with you one day forever and ever. That's the kind of joy that we all desire, Lord, and we want it. Please help us fight off all those pleasures of this world and things that choke out our relationship with you. Lord, you're so good to us. We don't deserve it. But I think that's part of why we have so much joy. Nothing in ourselves could ever produce what you can. So Lord, as we leave today, just I ask that if there's a person lacking joy, that they would come to you today, talk to you, want it, and then receive it. Lord, we're so glad, we're so joyful in your Son, and it's in his name we pray. Amen. All right, now guess what? It's your turn. Go out in the world, show some of that joy. If you know Jesus, go show the world, eh? We'll see you next week.